bothering me. What is that?
But they could all be something. Have you guys ever really heard good. About tulpas?
No, Wait, tacos?
Is that like a tuna taco or a tulpa taco?
Not tapas. Tulpas. T-U-L-P-A-S.
No.
I don't think anyone's tulpas.
I would try one if you have one.
I don't know. Possibly a story about tulpas?
Sure, yeah.
I just might.
Wow.
Regale us.
So basically, a tulpa is a being that's created solely through mental or spiritual discipline out of one's own energy. It's almost akin to the idea of like an imaginary friend, except that through focusing your energy and flushing out this being as real and fully as you possibly can into a quote-unquote person, eventually this tulpa graduates to a level of sentience. The ideas of a tulpa have their origins in Buddhism, specifically in Indian and Tibetan cultures. So in Indian cultures, they were regarded more as like a psychic power, an ability to create a mind-made body after extensive meditation.
So if I may, this is kind of like the dungeon master going, oh yeah, by the way, you also can roll a d12 for one spectral wolf.
Nerd.
That will attack you in one roll. Ease up, okay, please.
First of all, you wouldn't use a d12, you use a d20, but anyway.
Whoa.
Yeah, I don't know.
The DM I had was uncertified.
What rule setter is this? Is this d2 or d3?
DMT.
DMX.
What?
Take it outside.
So basically this being able to create like an emanation body provides the freedom for an individual to travel between earthly, heavenly, and other realms using this nirmita. That's what they call their emanation body. Multiple bodies can be created simultaneously in infinite forms, so they can traverse these dimensions concurrently.
How do you spell nirmita?
N-I-R-M-I-T-A. And basically, there's varying ideas in ancient texts that qualify that nirmitas are either some sort of magical, spiritual, or psychic creation. And I think there's one philosophy, the Madhyamaka, that makes an interesting point to the end that all realities are basically without essence. And so all realities can be regarded as form of nirmitas, in each to one's own. So this implies that if one can gain outside perspective on the illusory nature of reality, then one can, through this discipline, manipulate and change one's reality. This idea is very similar to that of Western occultism or modern day magics with a CK, like specifically chaos magic. It's really, really much akin to this idea. It's
cool. Would you say it's like the secret? Similar? Like I can envision this thing doing something for me?
Yeah, you're putting enough focus into this thing that it becomes real, kind of, almost.
Oprah doesn't exist.
Well,
no, this theory would prove Oprah is absolutely real.
And she loves bread. Yeah. So then going to the Tibetans, this idea again of the manifestation, and it's an astral body is sort of the same thing, that it takes a lot of mental conditioning and concentration, and it defines the strength and the power of your tulpa. But it also depends on the quality of the individual's mind who's doing these practices. And there are sort of some weaker formations that don't last as long, and they're known as tulkas with a K. But conversely, a well-trained and powerful bodhisattva has the capability to create up as many as 10 different varying types of spiritual and magical creations. Tulpas, servitors, avatars. There's six other ones.
This is like Yu-Gi-Oh in real life, basically.
Yeah, this is like became very.
I summon you.
Well, the Dalai Lama even made a quote publicly saying that his successor might appear at any time, even while he was still alive.
Because the current Dalai Lama, when they don't know who the next Dalai Lama is going to be, there's a whole
because it's a reincarnation process. But they said that he could still appear while the current Dalai Lama is alive in the form of a tulpa. But the Tibetans view it more as a hallucination, but they would tell students that it was to be regarded as a deity and would leave it up to them to figure it out on their own that it was a hallucination. Otherwise, you would be trapped in this miserable sort of theory.
Well, it's kind of like if you are thought-forming this creature, right, to either kind of like the Gollum of Prague, if you don't mind me throwing back, but at the same time, it's this thing that is helping you out with this certain life goal. And if it is thought formed, then that is kind of a self-fulfilled prophecy in that you need to have that positive mindset always. PMA.
Correct. That's very, very correct. But it's there's also a lot of a debate about whether these things actually take on physicality or not, or whether they are truly just a hallucination or something other than that. Inexplicable. Like the idea in the Tibetan culture of the independent consciousness arising in an individual's mind starts there, but it develops naturally, almost like a reflex. And once it has been established, you have to really care for this thing. It's almost like rearing a child. You have to pay extra close attention to it and nurture it.
Now it's like the Babadook.
Yeah, well,
like a Babadook that you
actually,
get to use.
You know what? It kind of
it's
almost
a useful
is.
Babadook.
It's like an evil version of a tulpa, because most tulpas are considered generally to be helpful as a tool. Like if it, for example, if you were afraid of spiders, you could create a tulpa.
Spend a lot of time over there.
You had a bad experience?
Terrible.
Tulpa spiders?
In this house? Well, it has to be in this house. It's the only place you've lived.
Absolutely.
Really?
Get an exterminator now. All spiders inside of houses must die.
I'm on it right now, man, daddy.
Thank you, Fritz.
All right, so say you had a fear of spiders, Angela, and you could create your tulpa, fully form them so that they have their own ideas and thoughts and voice, and...
Why?
You would be able to go into your mindscape, your wonderland, quote-unquote, that's what they call it, and it would be able to inform you, teach you how not to be afraid of spiders. It would show you the folly of your fears, and it would then strengthen you as a person. So it's used as sort of a tool or almost a therapy. In modern days, it's basically considered to be under the blanket of plurality, which simply means the existence of multiple consciousnesses.
Conscience is kind of like saying like a recess plural.
Fish. Like, hey, today you'll have multiple recess.
Recesses.
Let's go with that.
Reese's.
That's a candy. I'm pretty sure that's a candy. It's delicious.
Yes.
But so plurality is just basically multiple conscience existing within a single brain. The practitioner's conscience is always there, always present within every non-plural's awareness, but another non-plural doesn't exist in the mind of another non-plural, though they could communicate with each other externally. Again, a tulpa must be consciously created by an individual, differentiating it from mental disorders such as dissociative identity disorder, DID, or multiple personality disorder.
Yeah, that's what I was just thinking. It's like, it's just going on. This person's saying no one else is.
That's traditionally born out of some sort of psychic trauma, and therefore the mind creates it as it's a way to wall off those feelings.
Psychic trauma is so cool. They're really nice guys.
Tampa?
Yeah.
I thought so. And it's never been proven, yet there are stories about tulpas manifesting a concrete corporeal form. There's no accounts. There's one that's hearsay from Alexander David Nell, who was a Belgian-French explorer who basically went to Tibet and learned about creating these and came up with one in her mind and fleshing them out fully so she could talk with him. He kind of looked like Friar Tuck, like a happy little short monk bald guy. But then there were multiple reports of this stranger approaching their encampment where they were, and she was asleep. She had no idea it was there, and she kind of considered it to be a bad sign. And then more and more people reported seeing this stranger around, and when she would see it in her mind's eye, it had changed form and had lost a lot of weight, started looking more sinister, I guess, I don't know, big hairy eyebrows or something like that.
And so it was living on its own as a recently divorced tulpa, and it was taking good care of itself.
Doing laundry in its A-frame alone.
Rogue tulpa, huh?
But, so she eventually had to learn how to disassociate herself from it and destroy it. And the way that you actually create a tulpa is through, like I said, intensive meditation. It's a practice that you flesh out every specific detail of this. You have to imagine its physicality, what it looks like. It doesn't have to be human. It could be anything you imagine. It could be an object, a chimera.
So like a Sasquatch?
You could definitely do a Sasquatch if you wanted to. But
an extremely tall rabbit?
Specific. A really tall rabbit.
Very tall.
Like a really tall rabbit. It's not that large.
Like the Dark
it's
Crystal.
It's just tall.
Yeah, How much does it weigh, would you say?
About 10 pounds.
Yeah, but in addition to its physicality, you got to imagine its personality, its facets. And once this process is established, you can start to talk with it. It's called narrating. And you basically describe your surroundings. You encourage it to speak back, and after a while, it will.
You go crazy.
Yeah, well, then you imagine it has infinite amount of abilities within your mindscape, the Wonderland, as I referred to. And after a long time, you can start to project them over top of your real life. They call that imposing. And so it's like if you were wearing like a pair of VR goggles that you could see the real world, and then a character would be imposed on top of that.
Huh. Like augmented reality for your brain.
Yeah, and the process is never finished. It's lifelong. It's just like a human being. You're never finished until you die.
It's like a mental Tamagotchi.
Almost.
Jeez, nice. That's terrifying. All those dead Tamagotchi, like all you need to do is just replace the batteries.
We opened for Tamagotchi Graveyard in Tampa. Those guys are really cool.
Did you really?
Man, I heard they're sweet.
Graveyard.
Wow.
That's a good band name right there.
That is a good one. Oh, so eventually one can develop the ability to allow the Tolpa to start to take control of the body, to pursue its own wishes, and to interact with the real world. This is known as possession. And
that's pretty appropriate, right?
Some prefer communicating with their Tolpa in this manner, for example, allowing them to take over their body and it would handwrite messages to them and they could answer back that
way. Like spirit writing, but to another level.
Right. And then there's another step after that, beyond that, called switching, which is an advanced form of possession that the practitioner is completely disassociated from their physical senses while the Tolpa is in complete control of the body and the conscious mind essentially goes to a state of lucid dreaming. And for many modern Tolpamancers who use this to cope with loneliness or anxiety or depression, a fully realized companion for life that gives you perspective, who wouldn't want that? People have even talked about using it to treat schizophrenia. If you have different voices, maybe you can give them form and be able to better handle them and give them rallying, jockeying positions. It's just a better way to manage your thoughts.
It's kind of like that Pixar movie. Was it Inside Out?
Or is it more like Legion?
Actually, also, Legion is kind of a good example of what it might be if it wasn't another person, but if it had been created in his mind, it's very, very cool. the last sort of reference in pop modern culture to Tolpas was really in the 60s until just a few years ago with, the advent of 4chan.
Those guys.
So 4chan had a group for the fans of the children's cartoon My Little Pony, Friendship is Magic, which is dominated by what were called bronies, who are basically adult men that are huge fans of My Little Pony. It was sort of someone brought up the idea of Tolpamancy, and a lot of them started creating Tolpas based or inspired by characters from the show.
What?
And this led to subreddit groups and other websites and their instructional manuals on how to do it. I even read a 5-year diary of someone's interactions with Tolpamancy, and it actually turned out kind of sour. It took them around 2 months to really, really build up a great Tolpa, and they worked at it very extensively. This was a college-age student man who created a female Tolpa of a pony named Guiji. I think I'm pronouncing it right.
Guiji?
G-U-I-G-I, like Luigi with a G.
Guiji.
Or G-I-U-I-G-I. Guiji. Guiji.
Great name. That's a great name.
Yeah, and this person on the internet went by Coomer. And in fact, you can still read
Coomer
this diary.
And Guiji.
It's under.
Yeah, of course.
That old chestnut.
Yeah, exactly.
If you go to ponystasha.tumblr.com, you can read the whole
thing. Will not be doing
that. Not going to happen.
Going to definitely get put on some type of list.
But eventually,
I'm on it right now. It looks a lot. It's a lot of fun.
Well, this person, this man, had a great interactions with his Tolpa and was really dealing with some issues of depression and wanted it to eventually take over so he could just exist in his wonderland. And the Tolpa did so. This isn't the scary part.
Ooh.
Full on switching. This Tolpa was inhabiting this person's body, made posts on the internet, was going to class for them, but somehow allowing the walls to break down opened up the door to other Tolpas that had been created inadvertently in his mind that were much darker. Specifically, there was one named Ronale that encouraged
Ronale the Dark Pony.
Yes. Well, not, no, actually, he drew pictures of them and they look more like
it's
Slimer
like a
or some
Porsche.
Sort of floating ghost with sharp
Ronale
teeth.
The Dark Pony is way better. You
but Ronale was very much
dark
into
horse.
Drinking Scissorp. And doing drugs.
He was getting lit?
Yeah, he was getting lit.
Wait, you.
He's doing lean? We've got self-created brony Tolpas drinking lean? Is that what's happening right now in this
That's
world?
That's exactly what happened.
2017, baby.
Man, this world.
But eventually, Coomer, the host for all of these Tolpas, recognized what was going on, and it was basically a 2-year process for him to
get off
disassociate
the lean.
Wean off the lean.
Yeah.
Guiji, you gotta wean off the lean.
Guiji,
you gotta get off this
lean.
You
gotta get that old lean wean going on, or wean lean, whichever it would be.
It took him 2 years to break these habits and to put the Tolpas back into the recesses of his mind and eventually get them to dissipate. Like, there was weeks where he felt like he wasn't strong enough to enter back into his own body and take control, so he wouldn't. But he would do it a little at a time, and eventually, over 2 years, was able to take full control back over his body.
So it took him 3 years to make the damn thing, or 2 years?
He created it very fast. Within, I would say, 81 days, he was already married.
So what you're saying is he was already a crazy person.
Well, there's different people have posted on the site and asked questions and told him to go see a psychologist, psychiatrist.
Sure. Or several. Really
knows, you know.
Just as a hat tip, like, hey, you know, you might be crazy. You might be crazy. Out. But
you might be a tulpamancer or
a tulpamonger.
A tulpamonger.
I think that's Jeff Foxworthy's next national tour.
Tulpamonger?
You might be a tulpamonger if
you watch a lot of My Little Pony.
But that's what I'm saying. You got to be careful of all these spirits or emanations. They could try and get in your head, man. Take this over.
So, Nick Spry, would you say that maybe religious figures or even deities could be considered tulpas, like sort of mass tulpas? Everyone sort of believes in this thing and they
Zeus,
give it voice.
Poseidon, Hera, like Hermes.
Very well could Apollo. Be as a common energy, basically, right. Of a neural network, just putting it out there.
Can we all agree that the one group we do not want to become aware of tulpa, the tulpa discipline, mm-hmm. would be juggalos.
ISIS. Oh, no, yes, definitely. Yeah.
Oh, I can't imagine.
Brilliant.
Juggalos.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, we could all agree on that.
Giant sentient bottles of Faygo just
with ashes, emanating through the microverse of whoop, whoop.
I don't know. Stop it. I don't want to hear that.
It's a nightmare world.
I'm terrified.
That is a nightmare world. Yeah. Why would you even say juggalos? God.
Okay, but here's the question. Would you rather drink gravy water or Faygo?
Faygo, definitely. Yeah.
Gravy water. Gravy water for life, hashtag.
I feel like they'd make a good sort of cocktail if you kind of threw them together.
Kind of like how Mountain Dew was made for whiskey.
Exactly.
What wasn't?
Yeah. That's it.
Yep, there you go.
Oh, extra little tidbit, in case you were wondering, because I know you were.
Yes, we were.
Yes, some bronies do have sex with their tulpas.
Of course they do. That wasn't a question in my mind.
Which is basically called masturbating with the mind pony.